and it's the MD update. I've got two grandchildren, not the MD, so it's just personal.
And apologies for absence. At the moment, we've got Carol Pryor from Health Watch, Brian Simpson from Agenda Living, Nicola Allen from NHSE, Paula Cowan's got to give apologies, and Sarah Quinn is supposed to be coming in place of Dr. Lamb, she's not arrived yet. Pat Hackett, unfortunately, is away, but Anita has kindly stepped in instead. So, and Janelle is being represented by somebody that hasn't arrived either. So we shall see.
Any more?
Yes, Sarah Quinn is supposed to be there. Of the previous meeting, if people had a chance to leave the course with you. Any reviews? Yeah. Thank you. So, Julie, do you want to first? I thought we should perhaps have an update on coronavirus and where we are at the moment, so can I hand over to Julie for that?
Thank you. Thank you, Chair. So as you know, we're involved with this rising tide of numbers of people with coronavirus in the country. I'm just looking at some data, which is the latest data I've got from Public Health England, which was at 9 o'clock yesterday morning. I'm sure that the BBC has got different figures, but I'll quote them here to Public Health England figures, where by yesterday morning we had 373 cases in the UK, and yesterday morning we had 6 deaths, and have been in England yesterday 52. We have seen a rising number of cases day on day. In the Wirral, we've just announced this afternoon we've had another 2 positive cases who have been confirmed, which makes 3 in total in the borough. The 2 this afternoon are both people who travelled from Italy and who have self-isolated at home since they arrived back in the country. So they follow the pathway as we ask people to do with regard to travel and then if they develop symptoms. So I've said to a number of people, this is a new and evolving situation. It was only on the 31st of January that WHO notified the world that there was a new coronavirus, which is now known as COVID-19. And there's been lots of planning, obviously, that's taken place since then. Locally, of course, we're very alert to all the issues with regard to COVID-19 because of the work that we did at Arrow Park Hospital with regard to the isolation unit there. And we now know that all the guests have left. And we, I think, as a health and social care minor system, did a really good job in developing and setting up an isolation unit in a very short space of time and then providing a good quality service to the individuals. And that isolation unit did its job because we didn't have any cases of coronavirus emanating from the isolation unit. Of course, now, and I think the reason why we've had so many apologies this afternoon is, of course, people are busy planning for the impact of the virus on workforce and on the wider community. So, just to talk from a council point of view, we've established a weekly tactical group and we're meeting the second time tomorrow, very much focused on business continuity, looking at the communications that we need to get out to local people. We will also, in the afternoon around lunchtime, also talk to Chief Executive and Chair of the meeting across the health and social care sector to ensure that that sector is completely connected and working together, particularly with a focus, obviously, on our very vulnerable people. The Commons is really important, and I think we're very very much pushing the national communications policy, which is about ensuring people wash their hands, use tissue for coughs, and avoiding touching their face. But of course, it is an evolving situation. There is a high degree of anxiety locally and nationally. What you take from me is there's lots of thought going into the plans that we need locally, both around business continuity and about getting messages of assurance out into the general public. I think the other thing to say as well on Monday is that Chris is going to be chairing a cross-party group just so that we make sure that all the politicians are kept up to date with the situation as it develops within the country. But it is unprecedented, so people are working really hard, but in a very evolving and fluid situation. is the questions about when can we stop football matches, but I think it also very much would be around the social care campaigns and visiting, and what do we do about that. So I think very much as Graham says, we're very much following the national rules with regard to the policies we've put in place, but we're also thinking about it locally as well, because it's going to be how do we actually implement this locally when things come through. So doing a lot of that scenario planning and thinking through. But it's very much, whilst as a council we're not in the command and control, it's very much we are following what's coming out from COBRA and then what's coming out from the Department of Health.
On behalf of the Health and Wellbeing Board, can I just thank all the staff in all the different organisations for what they've done so far, and I think our sympathies are really with everybody when things perhaps escalate, but I think it's really reassuring for the board to hear, you know, the plans that are going on, and just like to thank everybody. So back to the agenda. Julie, you're going to give us an update on the Health and Wellbeing Board development review.
Yeah, which is a test because a lot of people in the room have been to the session, so yeah, we're really just going to do a bit of a recap of where we are, where we've been, and where we're going. So we've had three sessions with the board, with the support of the LGA around our development, and we identified that health inequalities is the critical issue for the world. But that at the moment we haven't got a single clear vision for place which articulates how we're going to reduce health inequalities. But we agree that as a board we should drive a system focus. We also discussed the need to have a conversation about where the board sits, both with the new committee structure for the council and within the wider rural partnership. So we're meeting again on the 1st of April. Because we agreed to develop a health and wellbeing strategy specifically focused on health inequalities and action to tackle health inequalities. So that workshop is happening on the 1st of April, and we've all received an invite to that. Supporting this work, the 2020 Public Health Annual Report is going to focus on health inequalities, and we'll be feeding back our initial findings and recommendations then to help shape our priorities. And then with an aim of producing a health and wellbeing strategy in June this year. So I hope that just gives you a bit of recap of where we've been. Three sessions with the LGA, which I think have gone well, but now in a place of converting that our aspirations and principles into action, and that will be the workshop on the 1st of April with a view to publication in June.
Thanks, Julia. I think the development days have been really useful. Any comments on that? Yes, Paul?
I just want to reiterate that I'm unfortunately didn't get to
the session. Oh, Paul, I'm really sorry. Microphone, do you want to?
What to move for?
Well,
all of you. We haven't said anything now. I just wanted to reiterate what Julie said. I think the sessions have been very well facilitated and been very informative in terms of helping us understand what the benefits of health and wellbeing are could bring to rural. The challenge is, of course, turning that into something that we can take forward as an action. So I'm sure we'll get there. As well as the support, what you've been saying.
Thank you. So we're on to the Marmot community.
Yes.
Julie.
Okay. This is a bit of a double act with Simon. So, and it does follow from the previous item. So, the healthcare partnership across Cheshire and Merseyside have put forward a proposal to work together across Cheshire and Merseyside with Michael Marmot and his team to develop a Marmot community. So, for those of you who don't know, so Michael Marmot is a world-renowned expert with regard to action to tackle health inequalities. His 10-year report. His 10-year review of his initial report was published last week or the week before, really, saying that we're really on our way up the pace with regard to action to tackle health inequalities. So the healthcare partnership is suggesting that we work work with the Marmot team to actually be very clear about the actions that we need to take locally. We can have access to their expertise with regard to what are the key actions that we need to move this work forward. And I think it supports very well the work of our health and wellbeing strategy and how we want to develop that. And healthcare partnership are prepared to pay for them because it has to be a membership fee. So they're going to pay for this across Cheshire and Merseyside, and then we can access the evidence base and the expertise, as I said, from the Marmot community. Simon, do you want to ask?
Yeah, I think I've been fairly close to through the healthcare partnership work, but also I think this makes absolute sense to Wirral in the context of the Wirral funds currently out for consultation with local people. It makes sense in terms of aligning developing health and wellbeing strategy, because it is about tackling the social and economic determinants of health. It's about managing that in a way that focuses on the needs of the population and justifying those needs. So working with local communities to maximise the assets within those communities and take that asset-based approach. It also very much for me defines what the role of health and care is within an integrated system, because I think the data suggests we go in fact about 10%, I think 20% as a maximum of people's health and well-being. Much of that is driven by the socio-economic determinants as well. As it says on page 15, page 7, the report, page 15 of the actual plan, it links into many of the local initiatives. And because it takes a life course approach, it is, as people said, worm to worm, it's actually from preconception to where people learn from palliative care, life, and ensure that we actually put that at the centre of what we're trying to do. As well as tackling issues such as poverty, deprivation, and so on in a systemic and system-wide way. So I think there are considerable benefits to being part of the Marmot community, least of all collaboration with one of the finest brains on this in the world, the ability to bring in additional resources to help us to deliver our objectives around improving the health and well-being and economic and social standing.
Having talked about, for example,
concern